Critic Jeff Andrew of Time Out raved that it looks terrific, moves along in a gallop, and is marvelously good-natured. The Chicago Reader's Dave Kerr calls it a hopelessly schizophrenic film, obscenely eager to compromise its own reality. And Peter Travers of People Magazine said that their space trip may be familiar, but they make it fun. On this episode of Ruined Childhoods, we decide the fate of explorers.
Reboot. Which one will it be?
It's the Ruined Childhoods podcast.
Greetings, starfighters and explorers.
Oh, hello, explorers. For anybody who made it to the end of our last episode and saw that we were teasing a different movie for this episode, we apologize, but we had to reschedule our heavyweights episode, but we have pulled an audible.
And which perhaps you are listening to this on Audible, though I don't think Audible carries the Ruined Childhood podcast.
I don't
or
know.
Any podcasts. I don't know.
I don't know.
Anyway, we apologize for not delivering heavyweights this week, but we promise you that that episode will happen. And we don't apologize for switching and, like John said, pulling an audible and going with 1985's Explorers.
Yeah. And just to give everybody a little bit of background about our theme for this month, which is focusing on child stars. The reason we're doing that is because our heavyweights episode will feature Box Brown, the author of, and I'm holding up the book right now like I'm David Letterman or something, but Child Star, a new graphic novel by Box Brown about a child star named Owen Eugene. And I'm a little ways into it. It's really wonderful. It's, you know, plays like a documentary and it just nails every, I can't wait to talk to Box about it. It's so good.
We also that the theme kind of, it does come from what we talked about a lot last month during July with at really from beginning to end, because we started with the Lost Boys and talking about the Coreys and Corey Haim and Corey Feldman and you know, the tragic way that they were both treated and the you know, tragic ending that Corey Haim suffered. And then we ended the month with the client and talking about Brad Renfro, which another tragic case of Hollywood and it's what being a talented young kid can bring to you. And it's worth, I mean, I guess pun unavoidable, exploring. So,
well, and we'll talk about that with Box a little bit too, because in Child Star, it does go into some pretty dark areas. It's not just like a, you know, fun times. This is about a precocious little kid kind of situation. And, you know, it definitely explores that type of thing that happens all the time with kids in Hollywood.
And Child Star focuses on a child star from the 80s, which is, I think, and of course, you know, Child Star, there have been children since, you know, I mean, Shirley
Temple. There have been children since the beginning of time.
There have been children since the beginning of time. No, but I mean, children in movies, children in TV. And I think the 80s was when it became, when we started getting a lot more tabloid television.
Yeah,
I think that also, I think, you know, maybe a benefit of tabloid television was we started to see a lot more of we started to see the results before we started to understand the causes of what happened to, you know, talented, bright young people with a lot of potential ended up much in the same way that, you know, Owen Eugene in Child Star and in real life, so many others, including Corey Haim and Brad Renfro.
What you talking about, Dad?
So and then there's then there's also those who have, you know, quote unquote, survived.
Sure. Yeah. And thrived.
and thrived. Yeah. And you know what? Today we're kind of going to be looking at both ends.
Yeah, but before we do that, I do want to revisit Joel Lie for just a moment. And first of all, say it's really wild to watch movies that weren't directed by Joel Schumacher after like a month of just like cramming in as much Joel Schumacher as possible.
You're like, but I did want to point out, where's the steam? Where's the
I did want to point out that in 1996, when A Time to Kill came out, that was, we were talking about other Samuel L. Jackson movies and how he was like on a real hot streak. And that was really like, I guess like the beginning of when things were really, really blowing up for him. And that was the same year as The Long Kiss Goodnight, 1996. So man, can you think of two more different movies? Probably, but I mean, very, very different characters all in the same, both in the same year, just goes to show you how talented that guy is.
He really is. And you, again, you start to think about Samuel L. Jackson and the movies around that time. And then, oh, my God, Losing Isaiah was right around that time. And incredible dramatic performance. And 1991 was when he was in Jungle Fever, played Wesley Snipes' brother.
Yeah.
And was amazing in that. I know he won. I don't think he was nominated for an Academy Award, but he won some awards. And even if he didn't, it's a phenomenal performance by Samuel L. Jackson. Samuel L. Jackson has popped up in many. Samuel L. Jackson pops up in Exorcist 3.
Oh, yeah.
Randomly. Randomly. And he's just, it's like during a dream sequence, and George C. Scott looks at him and he's just like, what you looking at? And sorry, no, I'm not, you know, I'm trying to keep, because we're talking about a family film, a PG rated film. As I was about to go for the MF bomb, it occurred to me, rein it in, Dan.
So yeah. One other thing that I wanted to mention about A Time to Kill, and you had brought up very briefly that there was a stage adaptation of it. And I just wanted to touch on that a little bit more. It was an, it was a Broadway show that lasted only 4 weeks.
Not a musical.
Not, no, my God, no, definitely not a musical. Judge Noose, I don't know if the character name was the same in the show, but the judge is played by Fred Thompson, the actor turned politician turned then actor again.
I did not know he had returned to acting. I believe he was serving in Congress. Fred Dalton Thompson.
Yeah, well, I mean, he was the judge in this, so
I had no idea. Honestly, I knew that there was a stage adaptation. I knew that it didn't last long, and I could figure out why. So
yeah, and the actor who played Jake Brigance. And I'm blanking on his name right now, but he's a total Matthew McConaughey look-like. Sebastian Arculus? Arcelus? If you Google, he was in House of Cards during one of the seasons. Like, he pops up in things all the time. And he clearly was cast because he looks like Matthew McConaughey. It's completely ridiculous. And the A Time to Kill Broadway show had a like YouTube channel that showed like little moments from, it was like little monologues from each of the characters. And I think that they actually play up the Roark character more, and hers is over the top.
I was raised in my father's law office and could write a brief before I could drive. I've watched men die in the electric chair and by lethal injection. And what did that teach me? This. When I grow up, I want to be a radical criminal attorney and have my name forever associated with the permanent abolition of the death penalty. You can view this man, this defendant, as an issue, as a cause, or, and I'm not proud of it, as an opportunity. You gotta let me in on this. Black father killing two white men who raped his daughter? It's the stuff my dreams are made of.
Oh, you know who wrote the adaptation is Rupert Holmes, best known for Escape, the Pina Colada song.
You're kidding me.
I'm almost 100% positive on that.
The same Rupert Holmes?
And I'm pretty sure who, yeah, he also did like The Mystery of Edwin Drood, which is a musical. It was a great musical.
Oh, he did Edwin Drood?
I have no idea. Hold on. Let me make sure I'm not getting my Rupert's crossed here.
Well,
there's a lot of Rupert.
The show looks
there.
Like a hot mess, and no surprise that it lasted just as long as Joel I lasted.
Yeah, and
which
honestly,
is sad. It's sad when a show doesn't make it that far.
I mean, it barely lasted as long as our Grisham's episode lasted. So,
my God, was going to apologize for the length of that episode, but I'm not going to. You can stop it whenever you want.
Yes, exactly.
But it's worth listening to the end.
I agree. And well, because what it is it's kind of like, you know, when you see something like you see a debate, you see something on the news or you're watching court TV, which I don't even know if that still exists, but
court TV turned into true TV.
Honestly. Okay. Sorry. Yeah. Couldn't help that. True TV. We have
there's a lot of great shows on true TV,
but we have the legal. We have the legal, you know, part of the show, mm-hmm. and we had our objections and overrulings, and then we have our legal analyst.
Right. Yeah.
So
legal expert, but also law in the South expert. But
yes. That is not just legal analyst, but someone speaking from the experience of practicing sweaty law. So,
right.
and yes, Rupert Holmes, the player, as far as I can tell, it is the same Rupert Holmes who wrote the Pina Colada song. And I did not know his name is actually David Goldstein.
What?
David Goldstein. This is from RupertHolmes.com. David Goldstein, better known as Rupert Holmes.
Wow. And,
yep. Songs That Sound Like Movies, the complete epic recording. Ooh, a 3-CD box set. Hello.
How about that?
I don't know. It includes the entire run of the A Time to Kill play. Maybe he should have put music in it. Then at least would have been like so terrible. It would have been
fun.
Yeah.
Would have lasted a week longer.
Well, ultimately, it's kind of like having a book that's like a more contemporary To Kill a Mockingbird is good and it's useful, but having a stage play that's basically like the B-movie version of To Kill a Mockingbird, it's like the property devalues, I guess is what I'm trying to say.
Yeah, it's like a bar band cover of
exactly. You know. It doesn't elevate the property.
Right.
So
talking about elevating things, let's talk about explorers.
Yes.
Does that work?
Sustained.
All right. We can drop the courtroom jargon.
Will I be held in contempt if I keep it up?
Dan, before I go on with a synopsis. Yes, this is 1985. It is directed by Joe Dante. It was a script that was kicked around for a while, but once E.T. Found success, it was like, yeah, let's do this one. Let's do something that's
a never-ending story because it was supposed to be directed by Wolfgang Peterson,
right?
Who coincidentally, perhaps, shares a name with one of the characters.
My theory is that the name became that in honor of him. Like, I don't know.
I mean, the only reason why he didn't direct it was because he wanted to shoot it in Germany. And the studio was like, we'll pass on that. And
yeah, maybe Northern California.
Yeah, so, let's keep it local.
Yeah, or Bay Area, I think. So, Dan, do you remember seeing this for your first time? Or is this one that's just like
my first time seeing it straight through?
Straight through?
Like the whole movie.
What do you mean the whole movie?
Well, the first time I watched the whole movie beginning to end, I was not today years old, but 2 days ago years old, if we're using that. I don't recall. Look, perhaps at some point in the past, I watched it and completely forgot. I think I remembered starting to watch it once and then it wasn't quite what I expected or wanted it to be. But I'm going to go on record as saying I had never watched the entire movie beginning to end until this past week.
I know that I had seen it because there were things from the end that when I watched it a few days ago, were just like, oh yeah, I remember this. I don't know how I remember this. I didn't remember all of the movie, but I remember like bits and pieces when I would watch it and be like, oh yeah, that's totally familiar. But I think that I always would confuse it in my mind with Flight of the Navigator.
Yes, I was going to say, I think a lot of those movies around that time, because I had that same feeling, but then there were other things I was like, I have not seen this before.
Yeah.
But then, you know, certain parts that, you know, I'm sure we'll talk about, it was like they had that familiarity, but I was like, oh, that could have been The Boy Who Could Fly. That could have been, like you said, Flight of the Navigator.
Yeah.
Any of those, Never Ending Story.
Yeah.
So, it is celebrating its 35th anniversary.
That's right. Yeah.
This summer. So it was released in July 1985. It was released, I think, the day before Live Aid.
Oh, was it really?
And like a week or 2 weeks after Back to the Future.
Oh, okay.
Which is why.
Didn't really succeed all that much.
It was
directed by Joe Dante, who had success with Gremlins. And before I get into the synopsis, we'll just quickly mention this. The movie was rushed to release because they had like submitted like a rough cut or something. And then the studio, which I believe the studio, like the movie changed studios like halfway through.
Studio
executive switch, which is like dooming anything that's in production.
It's similar to what happened with Ishtar without the added misogyny.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
I think Ishtar was much more of a victim of studio politics, but Explorers was also, I think, just a victim of studio negligence.
Well, also their whole idea was just like, we got to get this out now because like it's going to make so much money. This is the perfect time to release it, not realizing that it was clearly not. And, you know, a lot of things were removed from the movie. Like there was, I think, like an hour and a half worth of stuff that just like disappeared, like a whole family backstory and more spirituality that was, you know, left out of it. And when you watch the movie without thinking about that, it's good. It's a lot of fun. But if you think about what it could have been, it makes you wonder, like, how much better could this have really been?
Yeah. And I want to say, before you even go with the synopsis, I really enjoyed this movie.
Yeah, it's fun.
I really enjoyed it. And I found it, I found that it had meaning. But like you said, there is an implication of deeper meaning. And there are hints of it still there. There was definitely one part that I picked up on and I was like, wait a second, is this like some crazy interstellar stuff going on here?
Oh. And, well, we can come back to that after we go over the movie as a whole.
But it's funny though, because that whole, it's the spirituality concept that was kind of the core of Exorcist 2. And Joe Dante had said, he's like, now, unfortunately, the only movie that will have explored this concept is Exorcist 2.
Right. Yeah, I saw that. So for anybody who hasn't seen 1985's Explorers, here you go. Buckle up in your little tilt-a-whirl pod. In his famous 1971 song, Imagine, John Lennon says, "You may say I'm a dreamer, but I'm not the only one. I hope someday you'll join us and the world will be as one." 14 years later, teenager Ben Crandall took those words to heart. Inspired by extremely vivid dreams in which he's flying above a giant circuit board, he recruits his geeky friend Wolfgang Muller to turn the circuitry of his dreams into reality. Not really giving a shit about what anybody thinks, except maybe his classmate Laurie Swenson, va-va-boom, Ben gets into a fight with his school bully Steve Jackson and his cronies, introducing him to Darren Woods, who swoops in and chases off Jackson and company. Since Darren, a resident at 123 Other Side of the Tracks Boulevard, lives with his alcoholic father, he takes Ben up on his offer to avoid going home for a bit. Together they visit Wolfgang, who has programmed his computer with the visions from Ben's dreams. He ends up creating a mysterious floating object that wreaks havoc in his basement. Once he finds a way to make the object visible and a little bigger, the guys run some more tests and discover that they can make this orb do whatever they tell it, as long as it cooperates. During one such experiment, the orb ends up forming a round Wolfgang, proving that it can transport a person. Excited at the possibilities, the guys steal some objects from a junkyard, hence the tilt-a-whirl, and build a pod for them to sit in, complete with an oxygen tank, and with the orb's help, now named Thunder Road, they can take it for a spin around and above the neighborhood. Their first stop? Obviously the drive-in theater, which plays a campy sci-fi movie about a space hero named Starkiller. They eventually came face to face with the local sheriff's helicopter that orders them to land. But that's when the orb takes control and zips them across the sky to the edge of the atmosphere and then safely back to their point of origin. The town is abuzz with news of a UFO sighting, piquing the interest of Sheriff Charlie Drake, who alludes to also having vivid dreams that hadn't been around since he was a child. Despite the near scare on their maiden voyage, the guys decide to take the orb up in the air once more, but this time, the orb completely takes over and brings the guys into outer space and directly inside of a spaceship. As they step out of the Thunder Road, they fall into various traps and into odd tubes. They encounter a spider-like robot that pokes and prods at them. They all seem to get separated at different points. Ben and Darren, now separated from Wolfgang, encounter an alien creature. He's green and cartoonish and has a special talent for mimicking voices, first theirs, and then later reveals his ability to recount quotes and songs from American television shows. They find their way to Wolfgang, who is lounging with Neek, a female version of the first alien we encounter, and boy, is she female. In fact, Wolfgang appears to have a romantic attraction to her, and vice versa. The first alien turns out to be Hawke, Neek's brother. As it turns out, they took their dad's spaceship without his permission in search of human life, their biggest obsession. Hawke admits that he chose Ben because, as a dreamer, he would teach them about human life. Their belief is that if they came to Earth, they would be treated with violence, the same way that it's depicted on television and in B-movies, which Hawke and Neek believe to be documentaries. Once Hawke and Neek's dad busts them, they send the guys back to Earth, but not before Hawke can give Ben an amulet as a gift. The stuff dreams are made of, Hawke says. Back on Earth, the Thunder Road sinks into a lake, leaving the guys nothing but their memories and the amulet. But someone else who starts seeing visions in their dreams watches them. Lori Swenson, and once Ben is able to activate the amulet, the guys, along with Lori, can fly together through their dreams over the larger-than-life circuitry. And as Sir Paul McCartney said in his 1989 song Flying to My Home, the sky is like a painted flag above a sea of chrome. I've got a woman living in my life. Living in my home. I'm flying to my home. Sweet Majesty, I'm flying to my home. Ben is played by Ethan Hawke. Wolfgang is played by River Phoenix. Darren Woods is played by Jason Presson. Lori Swenson is played by Amanda Peterson. We've got James Cromwell as Mr. Muller. Robert Picardo as Starkiller, Hawke, and Hawke and Neek's father. And let's see. Dick Miller as Charlie Drake, the sheriff, and Meshach Taylor as his deputy, I guess, Gordon Miller.
Yeah. So where do we begin?
We begin with these synopses are getting a little out of hand, and I'm admitting that myself.
I don't know. I was like, so you kind of bookended it there. Lennon McCartney, are we also going Hawke Phoenix? Are we continuing with the parallels?
here's what happened. So I started with the whole Imagine thing because he's a dreamer. Yes. And the quote just totally works with, you know, what happens in the movie. And then I was like, well, I should probably end this with something similar. So I Googled Paul McCartney flying song and found Flying to My Home, which is garbage. And I was like, hey, this works. I got a woman living in my life. Lori Swenson is in the picture now.
Paul McCartney, who had a band called Wings, but apparently did not do any songs about flying until
this
after.
Was at least the, this was maybe just the first one that came up. There could be others that we don't know about. He released a lot of albums, so.
And probably a lot of songs about flying. Honestly,
probably Jet. I don't know.
Yeah, woo, woo. That's like the only part of that song I know. Not a huge fan. In the show
Love on Netflix, there's a wonderful scene where Paul Rust's character is playing music at a party with this guy who's played by E from Eels, and they're playing Jet, and it's awesome.
See that.
It's fun.
I get that. No, that sounds good.
I imagine it's a fun song to play. There you go.
Yeah. Yeah. So there's a lot. This is one of those movies, by the way, that if you're watching this now, and especially if you're watching this for the first time now, and especially if you are of the younger generation that would not have seen this when it came out, Stranger Things, Stranger Things is an amalgam, if you will, of this genre from the 80s, which was really, I think, this kind of kid wish fulfillment subdrama.
Kids who have like no supervision, you know? Yeah. Complete
fantasy.
Well, also,
I mean, it was the 80s when you could just be like, yeah, I'm going to go ride my bike until I can't see in front of my face anymore.
Yeah, pretty much.
And, you know, climb rusty fences and go into junkyards.
Yeah.
But the kid fantasy of it's the, you know, the shy kid, the geeky nerdy kid who somehow they rise above. This is going to be a continuing theme, of course, mm-hmm. in these movies, but there's this adversity. There's the, you know, quote unquote, the kids who beat them up, the punks, which in Monster Squad, it's EJ.
Yeah.
And his crew. And then.
Oh, yeah.
Well, and then Darren is the Rudy. I mean, Monster Squad came after this, so I guess Rudy in Monster Squad is the Darren.
Right.
Here. Yeah. Who, you know, that really cool kid who is like, I'm okay, fine. Like, I'm going to hang out with these nerds and get smart.
Right. Yeah. And well, he's reluctant to hang out with them. But then, you know, Ben, Ethan Hawke's character, kind of like follows him home because, you know, he's just like, hey, this, first of all, Ben is like, this kid is fearless. He doesn't care that he's getting beat up so much. He talks back to the bullies as they're like punching him in the face.
Yeah.
And, you know, he's just so super friendly that he's just like, hey, you help me out there. We should be friends. And essentially just like follows him home. And then Darren's just like, I guess my dad's home. I guess he didn't get that job. He should probably go somewhere else for a while because clearly there's something going on there.
It's very, outsiders-y.
Yeah.
And then Wolfgang's parents, James Cromwell and Dana Ivy,
Right. Yeah, Dana Ivey.
By the way, John, there are so many. Speaking of Dana Ivey and her performance in this, which she uses an accent that reminds me of the accent she. Oh, wait, am I thinking of the wrong person? Is she the one in Adam's Family who plays Dr. Pinterschloss?
Yes.
So there's that. There were a few other moments in the movie where I was like, that's something from Neek. Is Neek the prototype for Greta Gremlin?
Oh, totally. Totally.
Did you catch the Kingston? There's a Kingston Falls reference in the paper. Yeah. There's so many elements. You know, when Ben wakes up in the middle of the night and he walkie-talkies
Wolfgang.
And the kids using the walkie-talkies. You know, I read this great piece last week in The New Yorker, and it was about how writers are coping with cell phone technology and how like landlines are not, how landlines are such a great device in movies. And I mean, I think of Cape Fear, that great jump scare that comes from the telephone ringing in Cape Fear.
I've been wanting to rewatch that one for a while. I got to do that.
I rewatch that one every few years. That's so good.
It's so good.
Yeah. And the phone, one of the many great scares in that movie comes from the phone ringing. And it's another lost thing between kids. I don't know if young kids still do that before they get their cell phones. Is communicate via. Well, also, it's like in all of these movies, they all live like really close to each other.
Right.
Well, not Darren.
Yeah, I don't think that the walkie-talkie makes it to the other side of the tracks.
Reception does not cross the tracks now. But it's like adorable. Oh, and there's also that orb when the little orb is shooting around. Mm-hmm. I was thinking of Gremlins 2 again. I was thinking of the Electro Gremlin.
Oh, yeah, the Electro Gremlin.
Yeah. There was a lot. And there's also that you mentioned in the synopsis, Dick Miller's character who talks about having these dreams, like similar dreams to, you know, the dreams about these things and how it's, and I had this moment of like, wait a second, does he turn out to be like, is that Ben? Like, is that an adult Ben?
Oh.
Which is not the case, but it's part of this concept of the world mind.
The way that I, you know, interpreted it is that, you know, walks and neeks from the past, or it could have been them. We don't know how old they are or, you know, what the lifespan is of a creature like that, that they were trying to channel him as a child. I mean, mm-hmm. it just so happens that Ben was friends with a kid who could actually make this stuff real. So it's possible that just in the past, they were trying to channel somebody else, such as, you know, Dick Miller's character, and, you know, just nothing ever came of it.
Well, they did say they specifically were trying to, you know, get Ben.
Well, yeah, they knew they wanted to get Ben, but who knows how many attempts there were in the past.
I mean, I think you can also like, look, Joe Dante had intended it to be part of this, like this global, this world consciousness where we're all psychically connected, and which is also the concept in Exorcist 2 that allows Richard Burton to enter Linda Blair's dreams. I also think it just speaks to the imagination that we have as kids. It speaks so much to that. The movie speaks so much to that because look at Hawke and Neek. They're kids who are curious about other worlds, just like Ben and Wolfgang. And then Darren gets into it. But for a kid like Darren, he's got to be more grown up. So it's interesting to see how Darren isn't really in touch with that imagination, that part of that kid inside.
Right.
Until
he had to grow up a lot faster.
And he had to make it. But he's a good person. He puts the bullies on notice.
Right.
So. But you see his character as he becomes friends with Wolfgang and Ben, and they have all these adventures, he's able to be a kid.
Right.
When Ben is getting his ass kicked, PG, it's okay, I can say it. He does what a teacher should have been doing. This is on school property.
Right. Yeah.
Who Where was administration?
Charles Jones, high school, middle school, junior high. What was
middle
it?
School? Junior, probably at that time, junior high.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, yeah, he gets into that. There's that whole, that excitement, that creativity, that imagination of being a kid. And it's funny because you think about his dreams and you think about that, like, digital landscape, and it mm-hmm. kind of looks like the grid from Tron.
Yeah.
Probably intentionally, but
very
what if,
Tron-y.
Well, what if, you know what? This is a kid who would have seen Tron like 100 times in the movies. So this is not that long after Tron. This kid would have gone to see Tron. So it's, if you sit there and you're like, oh, they're ripping off Tron. Yes. And it's quite possible that a kid who sees a movie, who's obsessed with things like this, would see a movie like Tron, and where elements of Tron would end up in their dreams.
Sure. Yeah.
Yeah. It's kind of like when I was watching, when I was binge watching The West Wing several years ago, and in my dreams, there I was walking and talking with Toby and Josh and Sam.
There you go.
Yeah. I had office dreams as well. So, as in The Office.
Right.
But that's neither here nor there. Anyway, shared consciousness.
Right. So, I mean, I think that there's a lot of really fun moments in this movie. One thing that I was a little, I don't know, surprised about is that, and this goes for the character of Ben as well, but it's like, they do not seem to be as shocked as I feel they should be that they are in outer space. Like, they seem to be like, of course this is happening. Like, they do, they are on a very small scale amazed by it. But if I was there, I'd be like, guys, I can't even speak right now. Like, what's going on?
Oh, I'd be petrified. I'd be so scared of just like my head like compressing or something. Or,
well, also, it's like,
what's going to happen? We're in a fucking, it's PG-13.
It's fine.
Tilt-a-whirl.
They pass by the moon and they're not just like, oh my God, there's the frickin' moon. Like, I am so close. Like, they're not even trying to, like, see the Earth from such a distance. Like,
they are less astounded than some kids, than some kids I've seen in a planetarium.
Right. Yeah. And, you know, Ben has that sense of wonder to him, but it's definitely on a much smaller scale than I feel like it deserves to be.
He's much more impressed when he's floating in that bubble outside of Laurie's window. So,
va-va-boom. Yeah.
Yeah.
It's not great.
I know. It's not. No, it's not great. But also, like, he's 12, 13, you know.
Yeah. So anyway, it's, I, that's the only,
boys,
that's
my, boys.
That's my like only complaint is that they're not just like, holy crap, we are in outer space. Like they seem to just accept it very quickly. They're an alien spaceship. They're interacting with aliens and they're very much just like, interesting. I wonder what's going on. You know, they're not.
Well, they're there for 20 minutes and Wolfgang is like dating one of them.
Yeah.
So I love, before we kind of get into discussing more of the, and going back to the themes, I want to just take a moment to go back to the themes. So there's that theme of that childlike, of that wonder.
Mm-hmm.
But what I love about Wack and Neek is that they're also curious, but they're also afraid. And just like those science fiction movies that Ben watches, it's about the evil aliens and the Martians and the War of the Worlds, and they come to invade, and it's propaganda.
Yeah.
And Wack and Neek have seen the same thing, and they also want to know. And this is kind of another thing they miss, because they're, I guess the kids are kind of scared at first, but they have this similar fear, and they, because they see propaganda, and they think, oh, if we go to Earth, we're going to get killed.
Right.
And except I'm watching that and thinking, from this behavior, from what we're seeing, that is more likely.
Right. But you have to imagine they've also seen things like E.T. where they're just like, oh, but children, you know, if we can find a way to talk to a child, then maybe we have a chance of not being killed on the spot.
Right. Yes. So children who have that wonder,
yeah,
but also that, like, not the hate.
Right. Which clearly Ben does not have the hate. He's, you know, taking it from the bullies and just like mocking them, essentially.
Yeah. You know. So just to, and by the way, I have to note, at a certain point, I'm watching it. I'm like, this reminds me of a Rick and Morty episode.
Oh, yeah.
Not that Rick and Morty have done an Explorers episode, but just the idea of, like, they get to this, they're on this spaceship, not acting very phased at all.
Right.
And the aliens, of course, just have these, like, weird questions or want to know these things. And even Neek falling for Wolfgang, would happen to Morty.
Okay. I don't watch Rick and Morty.
Oh, you haven't? Okay. Mm. Yeah.
I tried. It just didn't take.
Oh, very bizarre. Very bizarre. Yeah. But there was, a few episodes that I found to be very funny. So, but yeah, that whole part where Ben is explaining to the alien, like, no, those are just movies. That's not real. And like, yeah, but I guess people on Earth are kind of crappy. Great performance, by the way, by Robert Picardo.
Right. Robert Picardo, as we have previously discussed on our Inner Space episode, the cowboy.
Mm-hmm, the cowboy.
He's so good.
Gremlins 2. So Joe Dante, which Joe Dante, like, we have the Joel Schumacher players. There's the Joe Dante players as well. Yeah. Robert Picardo is the Robert Picardo and Dick Miller are the Joe Dante players.
Dick Miller for sure.
Yeah. I was watching this movie and it made me think so much of how good Joe Dante is at just at capturing that imagination and showing you what really is, I think, close to a child's fantasy of think about it. If you're the kid who gets beat up at school all the time, you get picked on. Your wish is to be like, oh, yes, screw you. I'm going to build a spaceship out of a tilt-a-whirl and fly that right through the movie screen at the drive-in.
Right. Oh, it's very satisfying. It's a fantasy movie.
Imagine if Joe Dante had directed Honey, I Shrunk the Kids.
I would like to see that.
I
miss Joe Dante.
We're not talking about Honey, I Shrunk the Kids today. We may at some point, so I want to reserve discussion. But as I was watching this movie and thinking about Joe Dante's gifts, and I think about Honey, I Shrunk the Kids, which is a movie that is very visually impressive, but I feel like there's Joe Johnston in general, I feel like his movies there's like a barrier where it's like, I'm enjoying watching this, but I'm not connected to it.
Mm-hmm.
Not in the way where I connect to a movie like Explorers or really any of Joe Dante's movies where he brings in, you can relate, you can connect. He's got that. Explorers was supposed to explore the world mind. This is kind of the world heart, you know, those things that deep down we can all identify with. And that, you know, being a kid and wanting to expand beyond the boundaries of being a kid and to do something extraordinary. And whether it's, you know, something a little bit older, like, Billy Peltzer in Gremlins, though you still have the Corey Feldman character in Gremlins.
Mm-hmm.
But you have those kids.
God,
who
I always,
like,
forget that he's in Gremlins.
Yeah, yeah. And it's just like that, hey, yeah, we got this thing going on and we're going to stop it. And it's happening here in my town. It goes through everything. The Monster Squad, Flight of the Navigator, that I'm going to be the last starfighter. I'm going to be the kid who, that video game kid who everyone says, if you just keep going playing video games, you're going to go nowhere. Well, I'm going to go nowhere they've ever heard of before.
Yeah.
So he captures that so well. And I think of a movie like Honey, I Shrunk the Kids that I never really felt like I connected to and just felt, wow, what if like a 1989 Joe Dante had directed Honey, I Shrunk the Kids?
Well, you also have to remember that he did like The Burbs, which
was 1989.
Which he does such a good job of capturing small town life in, like, a lot of his movies, the weird things happening in small town, like suburbia.
Mm-hmm.
And Honey, I Shrunk the Kids is a weird thing that happens in suburbia.
The extraordinary, the what's going on next door. And Corey Feldman again.
Corey Feldman. Mm-hmm.
A Joe Dante player.
Yeah. So we've talked about James Cromwell, we talked about Robert Picardo, Dick Miller a little bit. Let's start talking about our child stars. This is the first time we've ever seen Ethan Hawke, and this is the first film for River Phoenix.
Yeah. Ethan Hawke went to the audition to hang out with his friend, and
right.
I think it was Joe Dante who was just like, oh, that kid looks...
I remembered hearing Ethan Hawke on a podcast a few years ago, and he talked about his start, which was exactly this. And man, what a first time knocking it out of the park. He's so good. He's so good. And it's no wonder that he's gone on to do so many amazing things. I love his Linkletter films, and I don't know if you saw the movie Juliet Naked that came out a couple of years ago, maybe a year or so ago.
No, I've heard
Chris O'Dowd and Rose Byrne. It's really, really good. He plays like an aged rock star who's kind of fallen out of, I don't know, everybody's consciousness. And it's very good.
Ethan Hawke's career has been, I think, very much of his making. But part of that has to do with the fact that Explorers wasn't a hit.
Yeah.
Explorers was a failure, and he was kind of the lead. And he kind of stopped. He was like, okay, well, I guess I'm going to go to high school. I'm going to go, you know, get a degree in English. And like, you know, he was just kind of like, okay, well, I tried this and that was fun, but that didn't work. I can only imagine he also had, I know his parents were divorced, and I imagine he had solid guidance and support, but he was also kind of allowed to go back and be a kid. And it wasn't until it was four years later that he does Dead Poets Society.
Right.
And then that.
God, it's so good.
That's what really kind of launches his career. The, you know, Explorers was a false start. I read an interview with Ethan Hawke in the Irish Times from 2017.
He was the Irish Times.
He was promoting a film that he had made in Ireland. Co-starred with Sally Hawkins.
With Sally Hawkins. Because I'm pretty sure that Juliet Naked was also in Ireland. Anyway.
Possibly. I mean, I think he is Irish, and his daughter was over there shooting.
His daughter also in Stranger Things.
Oh,
season
yes.
Three.
Wow. Okay. Sorry. Never met him. Yeah. His daughter with
she's
Uma
great.
Thurman. Yeah.
Yeah.
And he said he talks in this interview about the failure of Explorers and his decision that he was going to, you know, to just like go to college, get an English degree at NYU. And then it's Dead Poets Society. But he was still wary of the business. He and River Phoenix were on their, you know, both did their first movie together. And he says, yeah, and River did make it. So I felt that very intensely. I saw that it was possible and that it hadn't happened for me. I felt that I had failed, but that prepared me.
We should talk a little bit about River Phoenix also to give context about how their trajectories went. And we can come back to Ethan Hawke.
Yeah. Sure. No. It's just he's commenting here on River Phoenix, which I didn't want to necessarily jump into this part yet. But he says it's not a good thing for a child to have coffee brought to them by an adult.
Yeah.
It's a dance with fire. I witnessed that with River's death. So wow. To kind of say, to lead us into talking about River Phoenix. Yeah. If he's on this movie set and having coffee brought to him, yeah, there's something not right there.
Yeah, I mean, River Phoenix, he was raised on a commune.
South America.
Yeah, I mean, he was born here in Oregon, where I am, but then was raised in this commune. And I don't know exactly how he ended up, you know, doing, you know, starting to get into acting. I haven't done that research. But yeah, he really got off to like a very fast start. And, you know, same with his brother Leif, AKA Joaquin, who is, I think, the year after this was in Space Camp, right?
Yes.
Yeah. So that's also, you know, showing two people who had the same exact upbringing, but, you know, one of them certainly taking their life in a more extreme direction.
Well, yeah,
not to say that he didn't have, that Joaquin didn't have his issues.
He sure did. Yeah. But he got
through it.
As we've seen. But also that following year is River Phoenix in Stand By Me.
Mm-hmm.
Which just, I mean, if it, you know, this introduced him, hit. But that really hit. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. And, you know, then of course went on to do a lot of really awesome work in some more independent films and what?
Oh, I'm doing a little in the moment research here on River Phoenix. And did you not know when you chose your quotes for the synopsis at the beginning that his middle name, Jude, is from Hey Jude?
I did not know that his middle name was Jude.
No.
Oh, man. Mom? Anyway, so River Phoenix, you know, he did My Own Private Idaho, like
Indiana Jones,
Last Crusade. You know, he was this like teen idol. He was this kid who like everybody was fawning over. And of course, was it 93 he died? I want to say
93.
93, yeah. Very famously died outside the Viper Room.
Which he co-owned that with
co-owned
Johnny
with
Depp.
Johnny Depp. Yeah.
Yeah. So just to give you a little background on River Phoenix here, and I think this gives a lot. This is from Wikipedia, so credible. In 1973, the family joined a religious cult named the Children of God. The family had settled in Caracas, Venezuela, where the Children of God had stationed them to work as missionaries and fruit gatherers. And he was quoted, River Phoenix was quoted as saying, they're disgusting, they're ruining people's lives. That, and according to an article in Vanity Fair, he was raped at age 4 and lost his virginity at age 4. Which he also said in an interview, but that he blocked it out. But then also, like, the reasons why this is thrown into question is years later, Joaquin would claim that River was joking that and saying it was literally a joke because he was so tired of being asked ridiculous questions by the press. So who knows? But they officially they moved back in the late 70s. They moved back to the States because the leader of this group was getting powerful and wealthy and was basically pimping out church members to bring in rich disciples. It's weird. He kind of reminds me of that, the cult leader character in Mandy. If you haven't seen Mandy. Yeah.
Yet. I will.
Yeah. It is bonkers. And then he started, I guess his mom started working as a secretary for an NBC broadcaster. And then, the kids were singing for Spare Change in Westwood, in the Westwood area of LA. And a talent agent spotted them and started booking them in commercials.
Wow. Okay.
Singing on the street, literally plucked from obscurity.
And this is just from memory. I believe they also have a sister named, is it Moon or Summer?
Summer.
Was there a Moon? Or am I just going complete Zappa here?
There's Rain.
Rain.
Yeah. No.
Okay. So, yeah. And Leaf, who then, of course, became Joaquin, but not before starring or co-starring in Space Camp, which has many, there's a lot of Space Camp references in the rooms of the kids and explorers. There's, for some reason, Space Camp is a big thing, which is also big in the news right now. They're in danger of vanishing. So I'm getting a lot of targeted ads being like, save Space Camp.
I have a old friend from high school, and her husband, I want to say, works for NASA or is involved in NASA. He's like a astrophysicist. So she's been posting things online about Save Space Camp. So, hey, like, Save Space Camp. That's a worthwhile cause.
Back in my television days, I was, you know, trying to do some development stuff to sell some shows. And one of them that we were pitching around was a reality show about space camp called One Small Step. And it, I think that there's something now called One Small Step, but it, I don't think it has anything to do with space camp. But wouldn't that be such a great name for a show about space camp? One Small Step?
Yes. Yes. You saw the look on my, nobody else. John saw the look on my face just now. Although I think I remember you mentioning that at some point.
I think I've got a one sheet somewhere.
I always thought that was a great idea.
I remember because I had contacted people with space camp and they kind of were like, I don't know if it's as interesting as you think it is, which is so funny because so many people are always just like, they should make a reality show out of my work. That's kind of what everybody would always say when I was in the reality TV world.
Oy vey.
Yeah.
So anyway, space camp. But yeah, I mean, but yeah, these they're kids. I mean, when you're kids, especially in the 80s, and this was pre-Challenger,
right?
Almost every kid had an obsession with space travel at some point.
Mm-hmm.
I did.
Space is like, cool.
Yeah. And when you're a kid, it's just, it's exciting and cool and fun and creative. Yeah. And there, anything could happen in space. You know, no one can hear you scream.
Oh, boy.
Yeah. So space is exciting when you're a kid. And I like these movies like E.T. Because I think like there was Close Encounters of the Third Kind, but right. That was more grown up.
Right. Yeah. That's about an adult who has the wonder of what's out there.
I mean, that was kind of the whole idea with E.T. was like, oh, man, imagine if we did this with kids.
Yeah.
Well, because kids have that imagination, and kids aren't going to like also see an alien and want to kill it right away. They're going to, you know, dress it up.
Especially if it looks anything like Neek. You know what I mean?
Oh, yes. Yeah.
Yeah. So, yeah. So
funny.
We talked about our rising stars, River Phoenix and Ethan Hawke. Did you want to come back at all to, was there somewhere where you left off in the Ethan Hawke interview?
Well, I think it's worth noting, like, we know about Ethan Hawke. Ethan Hawke has had success in independent film, in foreign film, in mainstream films, like, you know, Gattaca, Reality Bites.
Yeah.
He was like the poster child for being a Gen Xer.
Right. Totally.
In Reality Bites. Now, River Phoenix, who also had that going for him, because he had so much success at a young age and so much money, like he bought all this like land. Well, when he was 18, he bought his mom a house, mm-hmm. Bought land in Costa Rica when he was 18. He was nominated for an Oscar.
Yeah.
When he was in, it was 1988. Oh, by the way, did you know he was up for the role of Bill in Bill and Ted?
Really?
Yeah.
No way. Yes way.
Yeah.
Oh man. So another River Phoenix, Keanu Reeves pairing.
Yeah. Well, he met Keanu Reeves when Keanu Reeves was shooting Parenthood.
Oh no way.
With Leaf.
Yes way.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. So and then they went on to do. They were in Gary. I Love You to Death and. Mm-hmm. My Own Private. Gary's been slapping the salami.
My Own Private Idaho, which is so good.
Oh, so powerful.
Yeah.
And it's just, it's powerful. But then when you watch it and you see River Phoenix and you just see the fragility in his performance.
Right. And what's also interesting is that like when he was doing the stuff as a kid, like Explorers and Stand By Me, it's like, yeah, he's convincing at being this character, but I don't know if you would necessarily be like, what a great actor. It's like, what a good, competent child actor. But like, he really developed into like a really, really great actor.
Well, Running on Empty, the movie he was nominated for, he's pretty exceptional in that.
Yeah.
Right. If I remember correctly, it's been a long time.
But I'm just saying, like the first couple of movies, it's like, I mean, he's good, but the people also saw something in him where it's just like, you know, we got to develop this.
He also didn't want to play Wolfgang. He wanted to play Darren.
Well, who wouldn't want to play Darren? He's so cool.
Yeah. So, but that was the thing. Like River Phoenix, Joe Dante did an article, an interview with The Wrap. and was talking about how River Phoenix would always take off the glasses when girls were around. And of course, River Phoenix and Ethan Hawke had a little romantic rivalry going on for the affections of Amanda Peterson.
Amanda Peterson, who we also lost. I mean, she
We should talk about her.
2015, I believe. She, of an accidental drug overdose. I think that it was, had to do with some sort of combination of prescription medication she was taking, and I think the morphine was involved, but yeah, she had a rough go, but she was
2015.
Yeah. 2015. And, so she was also in
Can't Buy Me
Love. Can't Buy Me Love. Yeah. Can't Buy Me Love.
Another summer hit of 1987.
Summer of 87, man.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, very sad, very sad.
Yeah, but she, and it looks like she had a, like, some career, you know, appearances on different shows and in different films. But it seems like this was really between Explorers and Can't Buy Me Love that was the peak. And it's hard once you have that, once you hit that high of success,
right? It
can be tough for a lot of people to move forward.
Yeah, I mean, it's so great that Ethan Hawke didn't have that same experience and he, you know, took a different road and, you know, didn't act for a little while and didn't have that life for a little while.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And I'd be interested at some point, I'm sure we'll find out over the course of the next few episodes. But what I'm interested to talk about, maybe Box has some insight on this. Is there a mental health professional? Is there a child psychologist on set?
Well, you also have to keep in mind that the state of, like, you know, the perception of mental health in the 80s is very different than the way it is now.
Oh, I mean, like, is that a reform that's happened? Because to me, that's like a, well, they are. Yeah, no, clearly they didn't have, they did not have that in the 80s. And it was a stigma. And of course, the last thing you'd want any director to think is like, oh, no, they found out I'm in therapy. They're never going to hire me.
Right. Yeah.
And, you know, that's how a lot of these drug problems happen. I mean, they could all be, you know, none of these are unpreventable.
Yeah.
So. Yeah.
Well, pour one out. Amanda Peterson, River Phoenix. Very, very tragic.
I mean, Dick Miller was.
Yes. Okay.
Dick fine. Miller died of, natural causes.
I was speaking more of the child stars.
Oh, we're pouring them out for the child stars too. Yeah.
So I absolutely am. I'm a huge fan of Ethan Hawke's work. I'm so glad that he picked up acting after his little hiatus as a kid. But his performance in Explorers is really tremendous. He really captures that state of wonder that a kid with, you know, all these dreams could really have. So,
And I'm sorry, we are neglecting to even really mention Jason Presson, who plays Darren.
Right.
And who I really have not been able to find much.
Yeah, not much about him.
Yeah. I think Jason Presson just seems to be maybe one of those guys who, like, I think he's still. He's in Gremlins 2. He pops up in Gremlins 2. But
yeah, after 1991, he kind of stopped acting. He was in The Heat of the Night.
The TV show?
Yeah, an episode of Rugrats. Yeah, TV movie called Never Forget. But yeah, Gremlins 2 was the last, like, movie that he was in. So yeah.
But it seems, I'm guessing he, you know, like, made it out. He survived.
So far as we know, yeah.
Yeah, really can't find much on him. So Jason, if Jason Presson, if you are listening, please email us at ruinedchildhoodspod@gmail.com.
Yeah, we'd love to catch up with you.
We hope you're doing well because we really like doing Explorers.
Yeah. And,
I mean, even if we didn't, we would hope you're doing well.
Yeah, and perhaps there's even room for an Explorers sequel focusing on Darren Woods.
Oh, go ahead, John.
No. That's not what my suggestion would be. However, he could find his way into my actual suggestion. So, thinking about child stars, there's one name for me that sticks out more than any other name, and that's Jacob Tremblay. Yeah, I mean, hello. He's just so great. And I don't know, Dan, have you seen the movie Good Boys?
I have.
What do you think of Good Boys?
I didn't like, there were a few things about, like, I was amused, but there were definitely a few things about it that didn't sit well with me.
Okay.
So had nothing to do with Jacob Tremblay.
Okay.
So
yeah, I don't know.
He's great.
I think that movie is very, very funny. And I would love to see a Good Boys sequel that is also an Explorers remake. Because I like those three kids together. And yes, at the end of Good Boys, they kind of like, they drift apart. But what if the one thing that brings them back together is a shared dream?
If it was just kind of an almost like a South Park Explorers episode, where it was just kind of like, where as you're watching the movie, if you've seen Explorers, you're like, are they doing Explorers?
But it would be so great if, like, you do have an appearance by, you know, Darren Woods, who's, you know, kind of this guy who they run into is just like,
maybe he's their teacher.
I had this experience one time. Yeah, right.
Oh, like Kiefer Sutherland in the Flatliners remake?
Exactly.
I know a thing or two about Good Days to Die.
You know, or you could get an Ethan Hawke appearance in there. But anyway, or hey, maybe James Cromwell. There's some sort of connection there. But anyway, I don't know. I just think that it'd be really fun because I was thinking about Jacob Tremblay, who, of course, would be on the top of the list to get involved in something like this. And then it's like, well, who would I want him with? And it's like, honestly, I want him with those kids from Good Boys. They have such great chemistry together. They play off each other so well.
I also like the idea of in that genre of comedy.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Taking a sequel and making it a remake of another movie.
Why not?
I'm trying to think what it, like, I mean, our like studio property, does that even matter anymore? You know, I guess it's who, yeah.
I'm not considering the ownership of the rights or anything like that. But no. It is worth mentioning that, that Explorers was the first movie that was an actual like co-production with Industrial Light and Magic. So the reason why it is so effects heavy and really pushes it is because of the involvement with ILM. Is it ILM and Universal?
Paramount. Yeah. Which and then, you know, there was talk of a remake and then there was a talk of like a TV adaptation a few years ago.
But the thing that I want to stress the most is that Joe Dante has to be involved.
Yeah, well, first of all, I would like to see, and I've reached out via Twitter to Joe Dante and have gotten no response, but a director's cut, if there's all of this footage
this
is another thing we talked about with Ishtar, where it's like, did it really call for a director's cut to add in 45 seconds?
Yeah.
This sounds like it actually calls for a director's cut because Joe Dante says like it's his big, it's not what he wanted to make. It's why he doesn't, you know, remember this movie so fondly. So first of all, I would just love to see either a director's cut or a remake based on his original, on those original premises of his and the screenwriters.
Yeah,
so
I hear you.
I think that perhaps would not potentially be the Good Boys 2 remake. That would be kind of a more of a straight up remake, for which I don't necessarily have casting suggestions, but I
just as Ethan Hawke and pretty much River Phoenix were unknowns, it's like you never know who you're going to cast that's going to just like be the exact right person.
No. And I did have a couple of ideas for sequels or spinoffs. First of all, I think we're coming up on 10 years. I think it's time for Ethan Hawke and Julie Delpy to go where they have yet to go before Moonrise. I think Ethan Hawke and Julie Delpy and Richard Linklater need to get together and get into the tilt-a-whirl. And
yeah, yeah, it's before just, dinner,
before moonrise. It's before, yeah, before, no, moonrise. Before moonrise. Before moonrise, there it is. And they just, because they just need some time alone to talk. And the only way they can do that is by leaving the planet.
They've done midnight, sunrise.
Sunset was the first one. Right. Sunset was the second one. And then the third one was midnight. All right. Yeah. And then
yeah, before my midnight. Other.
Okay. Yeah. Yeah. My other idea would be for a sequel where a kind of a remake-y sequel, but a sequel in which brings back Ethan Hawke. You would just call it Explorer. And it would be, again, you know, where an alien species has made some type of communication. And if you produced it today, you could have it be the same species that's like, look, you said this wasn't what you were all about, but we have been watching things and we've gotten better and we've known how to we're not watching the movies. We're just watching what we know to be representations of what is actually happening on Earth.
Mm-hmm.
And it looks bad.
Right.
And maybe like the aliens making contact with Ethan Hawke, who of course goes on to be a NASA scientist, and making communication, or maybe he's not, I don't know. Maybe he's a video game designer. And right. But one way or another, they make contact with him and they're like, you know, maybe it's a warning and maybe they're saying, there's talk out here of getting rid of you guys if you don't stop messing around.
Hmm. Yeah.
I don't know. It's a little Arrival-y, also Ad Astra, or as I call it, Brad Astra.
Or I call it Dad Astra because it's about his father.
Yes. Yeah. I saw
Tommy
it.
Tommy Jones.
I saw it in the theater. So
really?
Yeah.
I tried watching it on a plane and then I tried watching it, right? But then I tried watching it at home where I have like great TV and surround sound and stuff. And I was just like bored to tears.
I was really hoping you were going to say, I tried watching it on a plane. I tried watching it on a train. I tried watching it in the house. I tried watching it with the mouse.
No, it is not a Dr. Seuss production.
I just could not get through it. Please explain to me, Brad Pitt.
Yeah, I think, you know, somebody made the point not too long ago that like when Brad Pitt is in, if he's like co-starring, if he's not like the lead, that's when he really shines. You know, if he's the supporting actor, that's when he like really shines. Cause
yeah,
he has the flexibility to not have the entire movie on him. So it can get a little weird, but yeah, Ad Astra, I think is a perfect example of like, maybe a little less.
Yeah.
It was cool looking. There were a lot of things that were really cool looking about it.
Yeah. I mean, I don't know. It was one of those nights, like we had a babysitter and my wife and mother-in-law, I think went to go see Downton Abbey, and
okay.
I wanted to see Downton Abbey, but did not want to go with the two of them. I was like, I just don't want to be a third. And also my mother-in-law tends to talk during movies.
Oh,
so,
no.
But I went to see, I think I did watch Downton Abbey on a plane and it was quite good.
Perfectly fine plane movie.
I'm a Downton Abbey fan.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah.
So but getting back to Explorers.
Yeah.
No, I think that there is room for some sort of revisit to the property. I love your idea of like giving Joe Dante his due to like, you know, create the thing that he wanted to create.
And maybe he directs it, or maybe he picks a director.
Sure.
Like this is what I would like to see more of going on. And I'm sure it happens, but where a director like a Joe Dante, a Steven Spielberg, and Steven Spielberg has mentored directors. We know this, but really to see a lot more, like Frank Oz is another one who I would love to see, like really take someone under their wing and not teach them to be them.
Yeah. Well,
but
okay. I don't know if there is any of that going on here, but I went to a screening of Scott Pilgrim when it was like first coming out at the AFI Theater in Los Angeles. And it was like, it was some sort of special screening. And Edgar Wright was there sitting with Joe Dante. And they're clearly buddies. There may be some sort of mentorship thing that has happened in the past, but it's like, look, I would trust Edgar Wright any day of the week with a movie like Explorers.
You know, I dare say I would trust Edgar Wright with almost anything I know. Like, Edgar Wright hasn't really done drama. I can't think of any Edgar Wright directed dramas off the top of my head, but I think Edgar Wright would direct a damn fine drama. I think just his skill, because his character, you know, there's a connection to characters definitely in his work. I think, and I like Edgar Wright. I like the idea of Edgar Wright working with young people. So, Edgar Wright would be a fine director to work with Joe Dante. As would many other directors be great for Explorers.
Agreed.
Yes.
Yeah.
Agreed. So.
Well, Dan, do you have any other thoughts about Explorers before we wrap it on up?
No, just I recommend it if you've never seen it
before. It's fun.
It is fun. It is, you kind of have to roll with it because it just goes in some unexpected directions. It is, one of the reviews that I read of it compares it to the other, you know, post Spielbergian films of the 80s, and it really being a standout in terms of like the just creativity and not going the expected route with it.
Right. Yeah.
So
it's a lot of fun.
Check it out.
I definitely recommend it. We are still working out our scheduling for the next episode, but it will possibly be Heavyweights.
It may be Heavyweights. It may not be Heavyweights.
Yeah.
We will, but we do have a lineup and we are, we're ready to go, but we're excited to bring in some folks to talk about these movies
and
some fun guests.
So far, the guests that we have lined up, both from our hometown.
Yes.
So for anybody who's unfamiliar with the town of Cranford, New Jersey, you're going to get familiar with it.
You are going to hear a lot about Cranford in the coming weeks. So,
one other thing I want to mention. This movie has some very pivotal scenes at a drive-in theater. Well, one scene at a drive-in theater and then other mentions to the drive-in theater. We are living in a time when theaters are closed. I hear that some are planning to open back up, which is scary. And a lot of theaters or organizations are going into the drive-in route, such as our hometown theater is doing drive-in movies at a nearby location. And I've been involved with a Portland organization. So I work at the Portland Art Museum, and our sister organization is the Northwest Film Center, which typically has movie screenings year round in the theater at the Portland Art Museum, but also in other locations for different kind of cinema experiences. And we are going to be starting up a drive-in theaters situation, which we've done in the past, but bringing it back because it just makes sense. It's the only way that we're going to be able to do it. So if you go to nwfilm.org, or if you just Google Northwest Film Center drive-in, Portland drive-in, you'll find it. And there's a really great lineup, and it's going to be pretty cool. So
if you have that near you, accessible to you, whether it's in Portland or elsewhere, patronize your drive-in, your local drive-in movie theaters. I don't think they're doing that near me, but as John, you've seen, I've got my projector and screen. I watched Explorers in my backyard, which was really fun.
Great way to watch it, I'd say.
Great way to watch it. And Explorers would be an excellent choice for a drive-in movie. So
I think that, you know, if I was programming a series of drive-in movies, it would be movies that have drive-in theaters in the movie. You'd have The Outsiders, you know, there would be a lot
Grease.
Of really fun ones. Grease. I just watched an episode of Cheers that took place at a drive-in theater. So
what?
It's true. In the last season.
I have no recollection of that.
It's in the last season. So Anyway.
All right, folks.
Maybe we'll be talking about heavyweights on the next episode.
Until then, good journey.
Good journey into the stars.